Let's say I gave you this text or string A, B, C, D, and also that string A, B, X, C, D. And then I asked you, what is the difference between them? Like, let's assume one of them is the original and the other is just a modification. And then I asked you, what modifications were made? What was added and what was removed? You could say, X was added there in the middle. So how did you know that? Well, you could say we have an A in both of them, then B in both, then there's an X in the second, but not in the first, then a C and a D. So X is not common, so it must have been added. Okay, fair enough. What about that one? A, B, C, D, E, F, and A, B, C, H, D, F. Let's follow the same strategy. A is here and there, then B, then C. Then we have H only in the second. Then there is a D in both. Then there is an E only in the first. And then there is an F in both. Okay, so it looks like E was removed since it's only in the first. And H was added since it's only in the second. So basically what we are trying to do is to get to the Diff algorithm. And I'm sure everyone in the software industry is already familiar with it. So it compares different versions of the code and tells you what exactly was added and what was removed. Okay, sounds easy so far, so let's get things more complicated. Now we have the following two strings, A, B, C, D, E, F, and B, H, D, E, F, C. Okay, let's follow the same strategy. We don't have an A in the second, so we start from here. We have a B right here. We have a C. We have a C right there. But we have already reached the end of the second string. So everything between B and C in the second string must have been added, right? So, I mean, like following that basic same strategy, we end up with 8 differences. We have removed A, D, E, F, and added H, D, E, F, which doesn't really sound right? So we have 8 differences and the only common part is B, C. Okay, for a moment, let's imagine that we ignored C. Just pretend you didn't see it and assume we didn't find a match for it. So we would say that we have D, E, F, they are in common. So in this case, A was removed, C was removed, H was added, and C was added. And now we have 4 differences. And the common sequence here is B, D, E, F, which is a better result than the previous one. But actually, if you think about it, both are valid results, but one of them is more valid than the other, because it has got more in common, and having more in common will have less differences and resulting in a more logical conclusion. Like, for example, if we have these 3 lines and I move this line a bit up, and you think, did I remove a line and add a line, or did I remove 2 and add 2? We have made less differences, made less changes, and this is the one that makes sense the most. So we need the less differences and the longer common subsequence. So these two results has got B in common, BC and BDEF. Yes, we didn't reach this result by a systematic algorithmic way, but we are getting there. So these two results are more like, if you put it together, it looks like a tree. So they started from B as a common part and then they went different ways. Well, except it's not. Because what if I add another letter like K at the end of both? So I add a K here and there. So now we have got BCK and BDEFK. And B and K are used in both. So it's actually a graph. It's more of a graph than a tree. And in this graph, we want the longest path. So the path length at B was 1, and at C was 2, at D was 2 also as well, and then 3 at E, and 4 at F. And then at K, we check the longest one. So basically, we have got 4 here and 2 there, so we pick 4 and then add 1. So at K, it's going to be at length of 5, because we are looking for the longest common subsequence. So how exactly do we connect these nodes? Or how do we even generate the graph? Okay, before connecting or generating the graph, what are our nodes here? Well, these are matches, which are the things that we have in common between the two strings, just without any order. Just like we have a B in both of them, we have a C in both of them, we have a D, we have things in common, but we don't know exactly in what order or how to connect them exactly. So we will compare every single character in the first with every single character in the second. So that requires building a table like that. And we need to mark all the places where we have matches. So we have a match here at B and at C and D and E and F and K. Okay, now what? How do we connect these things? Okay, let's pick D for example. Can C become a parent for D? Can B become a parent for D? Do we have any sequence where we have B before D or C before D? Okay, let's put all the sequences we have just to be easier to imagine it. We have BCK and BDEFK. So D is only preceded by B, which we can see lies within that part. And so does C. C is also preceded by B and it also lies in this part of the table. E is preceded by BD and we can see both of them in that part of the table. And if you're not sure how did that happen, let's imagine it this way. Imagine if we have the strings BHD and ABCD, like I'm just cutting a part of each string. And now we have a common subsequence, which is BD. And notice that part we cut is actually that part of the table. So if we have two strings and both of them has got a common subsequence, if we add one character to both, like E, the new common subsequence is going to be the same as the previous plus the new character. So once we include E, the new subsequence will have E as well. All of the previous plus the new one, if it happens to be the same, which as we said, it is that part of the table. So we need to put weights or lengths on this. So B is, it's a sequence of length 1, BD makes it 2 at D, and BC makes it also 2 at C. So at C, I will check the previous sequence from that part. So we just add 1, because here it's 1 and here would be 2. And I will do the same with D. So D is now 2 because that part of the table is 1. The maximum here is 1. And now let's check at E. Seems like 2 is the maximum here, so we are at 3. And then for F we are at 4. And then for K we would find 4 is the maximum here, so it will be at 5. Yeah, okay, so 5 is like the length of the sequence. But what is the sequence itself? Okay, we can backtrack this by starting from the maximum at 5, which was at K. Okay, so we have a K, we can push it to our stack. And then let's search in this part now. So we are already at K, so we are searching here. And we are looking for a 4, and it's right here. So that was an F. And then we search for a 3, and that's an E. And then we search for a 2, and that's a D. And notice we have never encountered a C at all. And that last one is a B, and this is our longest common subsequence. Just one more thing. I don't really like the idea of having to search on the table every single time. Like, that's a lot of runtime. So I just want the value to be ready for me, like right there, without having to search for the maximum every single time. So here I am at K, which is 5, and I'm looking for a 4. I just want the 4 to be like right here without having to look for it in the entire table. But if I have a 4 in this cell, what exactly would it mean? Like, I know that having a 4 here means like this cell in this table represents a match because it's an F and there's a match at F. But that one, it doesn't really mean anything. It's just that I'm bringing the value here, so you don't have to search for it all over the place. Okay, let's do it again from the beginning and see how do we bring these values closer. So A gets a 0 for all of them in this row because there are no A's in the second string. B is on the edge, so it gets a 1. So what do we put in this cell exactly? I'm not really sure yet, but let's jump to C. And we know that C has got a value of 2 because BC is a subsequence of length 2 and B comes before C. So C searches in that part of the table and we want to have the value here to be 1. So C is going to search in this part of the table, but we want to deliver the value right here, which should be 1. Okay, so here in the cell at age and C, I'm just going to put 1 because that seems to be the maximum around here, because between 0 and 1, 1 would be the maximum. And also here, 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 and here, and so on. So when we backtrack, wouldn't that confuse us later when connecting the graph? Like, how do I know if I should connect this cell or this cell? No, because we can still tell if that value is here because it actually was a match, or because it was just trying to spread the values around and deliver the maximum everywhere. Well, we can actually just put a flag or something so we can distinguish between cells that has got values because they are actually a match or they are just trying to spread the values. And for each cell, we will just continue putting the maximum value we find around us. So now in the third row, up until here, the maximum value seems to be 1. And here we have a match. And we can grab the value of the previous sequences from the cell right here without searching. We just add 1 and that would make C at 2. And don't forget the flag because it earned that value by itself and didn't just get it from another cell. And we continue like that. If there is a match at cell I and j, we get the value from the cell I minus 1, j minus 1, which is the diagonal previous cell, and we add 1 to it, and if not, we just get the maximum value around us, which is either the previous one above, which is I and j minus 1, or I minus 1 and j. And then, once we are done filling the table, we can connect our dots. So we go to the very last cell, which obviously would be the maximum one, and then we ask it, did you earn this value by yourself or you got it from a neighboring cell? Okay, you have a flag. Okay, so you are part of the longest common subsequence. Welcome to the stack. We push it to the stack. And then we remove K and we just move to this part of the table. And then we find a 4. But this 4 did not earn it, so it got it from a neighboring cell. So we ask that cell, where did you get your value from? Next to you or above you? And it looks like it's next to it, so we just move there. And now that one has a flag. So we push it to the stack and let's move to that part of the table. We have a 3 with a flag and we do the same. And then we have 2 with a flag and we also do the same. And now we have 1, but this one is without a flag. So we ask the cell, did you get it by yourself or where do you get it from exactly? But since both are equal, so we're not sure if we should move up or move left. So let's say we just move up and there is still 1 without a flag. And then we ask it, where did you get the value from? So it's right next to it. And this one has a flag, so we can just push it to the stack. And we are done. Of course, since we are trying to get the difference between two strings, we are also interested in the index of each character. So we will not put B exactly in the stack, but we can put where it lies, like what is the index of B in the first string and what is the index of B in the second string. So now string 1 has got indices 1, 3, 4, 5, and 6 that are common. So what happened to index 0 and 2? Well, they must have been removed. And then string 2 has got the indices of 0, 2, 3, 4, and 6. So what happened to 1 and 5? Well, they must have been added. And that's it. That's how it works. Well, obviously, we shouldn't really compare them character by character, but rather line by line. So if we added a new line character, which is like slash n, in a file, it will show that we have removed one line and added another 2 instead of showing adding this one character in the middle. But I guess you already know that. So thanks for watching and see you in the next algorithm.